Another shift in field strength, Captain. An increase of 21%. Suggest we pull back as a precaution.
Take us back 10 AU, Mr. Watts. Warp factor 3.
Aye, sir.
The field remains steady at its new level.
What's going on here? Navarro?
Welcome to the bridge, Dr. Crandall. What seems to be the problem?
The problem is, Navarro, that I was just awakened by something which, were I on the planetary surface, could be described as an earthquake. Now, I would like to know what its cause was, and I would like to know why it was not avoided, whatever it was.
The cause, Dr. Crandall, was an unpredicted and abrupt change in the fabric of space we were exploring. The reason it was not avoided is because it was unpredicted.
As far as we know, such changes cannot be predicted at this time.
I see. But the ship, was there any damage to the ship?
Not a bit. As you know, our sensors allow us to...
I know. There's an anomaly out there? Is that a new one?
That's right, the seventh.
Why wasn't I called? I am, after all, an official observer on this ship, which would seem to me to mean that I should be present during all observations.
If you will recall, Dr. Crandall, midway through our observations of the previous anomaly, you stated that you didn't wish to be disturbed unless something unusual happened. Something downright spectacular, I believe, were your exact words.
Well, something which rattles the walls of a Class 1 destroyer qualifies in my book as spectacular. In any event, now that I'm here, I want to be brought up to date.
What the hell is going on here?
How are we? Full stop, Mr. Hansen. Maintain present position. Mr. Watts, determine precisely our present position with respect to the point at which we first appeared in this sector.
Aye, sir.
Sonak, full sensor scan.
No vessels in sensor range, Captain. Radiation is a little higher in this area, but we're in no danger at present.
Sonak, any idea where we are?
Not yet, Captain. There is...
Admiral, I demand to know what's happening on this ship.
We'll tell you as soon as we find out ourselves.
Now see here, Navarro. Who do you think you are? May I remind you that I'm an official representative of the World Council, and I want civil answers to my questions.
We do not have time for your demands at the moment, Dr. Crandall. Security to the bridge immediately.
Lieutenant, open a channel to Starfleet Command at once.
Continue monitoring all frequencies, Lieutenant. Attempt no communications with Starfleet Command or anyone else at this time.
Navarro, I'll have your head for this.
Escort Dr. Crandall to his quarters and make sure he stays there. I will tell you when he's allowed to leave.
Yes, sir.
Navarro, this is mutiny. You had better rescind that order.
As you were saying, Sonak.
Yes, Captain. There is an area that appears to be Sector A37111 directly ahead, though the computers haven't positively identified it yet. If it turns out to be A37, then we will have been transported at least 5 million parsecs.
5 million?
That's if A37's ahead of us. If it's not, then we could have traveled a hell of a lot further.
Mr. Watts, have you located our point of entry into this sector of space?
I believe so, sir.
Very well. Mr. Hansen, take us to within a half AU and hold there. Warp factor 2. Sonak, prepare to launch a probe directly at our point of entry.
Probe's ready, Captain.
Launch probe.
Readings coming in now, Captain. Sensors cannot find any familiar extragalactic objects which it can recognize. Few external galaxies are visible, due to the cluster of stars we are currently in.
So what you are saying is, first, we are no longer in the Milky Way galaxy, and second, the computer can't even determine what galaxy we are in.
That's right, Captain.
Any theories?
It's obvious that the Hannibal passed through one of the anomalies.
That's what I thought. Anything further from the probe?
It has passed through our point of entry and has vanished from our sensors.
What are the odds? If we follow the probe, we'll end up back where we started.
I'd say, whatever the odds might be, they're better than any other method of return.
I see no other choice. Even at warp 8 indefinitely, we would still be several lifetimes away from the Federation. Mr. Hansen, set coordinates to match exactly the way we entered this sector. Warp factor 2.
Ready at your command, Captain.
Execute. Time, Sonak.
We passed through our point of entry 2 seconds ago.
Mr. Watts, how close were we to retracing our original flight plan?
Maximum error of 200 kilometers, Captain.
Sonak, could the anomaly be smaller than we thought? Could we simply have missed it?
Anything's possible, Captain. Based on all our previous data, though, it seems unlikely.
Mr. Hansen, take us back. Again. Something amusing, Ensign?
Not really, sir. I was just thinking what Dr. Crandall is going to say when he finds out.
Any theories, Sonak? Where did the anomaly go?
I don't know, Captain. It could be anywhere. Maybe it doesn't exist anymore. Unless a probe passes through one of them, it cannot be detected.
And our chances of locating it again?
I can't even guess. There's no data to work it out. Even if we find it, there's no guarantee that it'll return us to our starting point.
But it's our only chance.
The only one we are currently aware of, Captain.
I stand corrected.
Captain, we've picked up an object.
Magnify the screen, Mr. Watts. Is it a ship?
I believe it is, Captain.
mass approximately 100,000 kilograms. Sensors are unable to detect life forms aboard, if there are any. There's an operating power source aboard. Wait a minute. Power usage is increasing, Captain.
I would say that it has detected our presence.
Let's see what it's up to before we make any moves.
Power usage still increasing, Captain. The object sensor beams are strengthening. They're being brought to focus on the Hannibal.
Reflector screens up, Mr. Hansen.
Reflector screens up, sir.
Extreme power buildup, Captain. Laser discharge, Captain. It appears to be attacking us.
So I noticed. Analysis, Sonak.
Primitive laser weapon, similar to early Federation equipment. It's much less effective than our phasers, of course.
Any other weapons indicated?
There appears to be a number of fusion devices, but they seem to be without propulsion systems.
Can the laser be disabled without destroying the object?
Without deflector screens, all it would take is a burst from our phasers. About 3 milliseconds.
Mr. Hansen, lock phasers on target.
Locked on, sir.
The ship is malfunctioning. The power source is building to an overload, and they're going to... explode.
Damage report, engineering.
Momentary overload to the forward deflector screen, but no permanent damage, Captain.
Thank you, Mr. McPherson. Lieutenant, inform all department heads to meet us in the conference room in 5 minutes. Inform security to have Dr. Crandall be there as well.
Yes, sir.
Let's go, Sonak. Mr. Hansen, you have the bridge.
Captain Navarro, I feel I must apologize for my unprofessional behavior on the bridge. You were, I fear, quite correct to eject me as you did. Let me assure you, I fully understand your position.
I'm glad you don't bear a grudge, Dr. Crandall.
Of course not. You were only doing what you thought was best. And I must admit, I did let my emotions run away with me for the moment. But tell me, what is our status? I take it that since you are away from the bridge, our situation is not as serious as it might first have appeared. Tell me, can you pinpoint our location?
In answer to your last question, while we've hardly pinpointed our location, we do have a better idea than before how far we've traveled.
Well, good. That's very good. You and your people came through. Can you tell me how far we've gone?
We appear to be farther from the Federation than we at first thought. Several million parsecs farther.
But that's impossible.
I wish it were, Doctor. I truly wish it were. But it obviously isn't, because that's precisely what's happened.
But how? What happened? I thought these anomalies were too small to throw us a few hundred parsecs. And detectors my lab's built. Why in God's name didn't you use them?
We were using them, Doctor. The anomaly that took us here had no gravimetric signature. There was no warning.
But you must have known that...
It's a long story, Doctor. I suggest you listen to my officers as they try to answer your questions and ours. Now, Sonak has collected all available data and has come up with a very interesting theory. Sonak.
First of all, my theory is based on the assumption that these gravitational anomalies are not natural, but built by sentient beings. Therefore, they were built with a purpose, which I believe we've discovered.
Transportation.
Exactly. And if that's the case, two more assumptions follow. First, they have to be consistent in design. Second, they should be easily approachable. not concealed in the center of a maze of gravitational turbulence that could tear a starship to pieces.
Unless they were meant to be hidden. The Federation had something like this. Something that we could use to transport our Federation ships instantaneously to, say, somewhere in the middle of the Klingon Empire. Then the one thing we would do is hide it, and make it as difficult as possible for anyone other than ourselves to approach or leave.
True, Captain. But that's assuming that whoever built these anomalies did it for only warlike reasons. Hopefully they're more advanced in thinking than that.
Unless they were meant to be hidden. The Federation had something like this. Something that we could use to transport our Federation ships instantaneously to, say, somewhere in the middle of the Klingon Empire. Then the one thing we would do is hide it, and make it as difficult as possible for anyone other than ourselves to approach or leave.
True, Captain. But that's assuming that whoever built these anomalies did it for only warlike reasons. Hopefully they're more advanced in thinking than that.
Many humans thought the same thing about warp drive before we met the Romulans and the Klingons. But go ahead, Sonak.
I believe the seven anomalies we discovered in A37 were malfunctioning versions of the one that finally transported us here. Remember, this one showed no signs of gravimetric disturbances like the others, which is why we flew into it blindly. The others are faulty, and therefore leaked the gravity that was contained within them.
Excellent work, Sonak. But what can we do now? Look for the creators of these gates, for want of a better term?
Precisely. Considering we are not capable of finding these gates with our instruments, searching for their hypothetical creators seems to be our only bet.
What about that ship we encountered?
Their technological level was too primitive to be the architects of the gates, if that's what you're suggesting.
Unless they fall into that level for whatever reason.
Then I fear we will be trapped here forever.
Well, at least if they're not the gate creators, we'll be able to defend ourselves as we search for them. Any other theories, gentlemen? Any other course of action? Very well, gentlemen, that's it then. Sonak, determine which of the nearest stars are most likely to have habitable planets. Mr. Hansen and Mr. Watts will plot a course to the nearest half dozen. And of course, everyone maintain a continuous lookout for other craft and for any indication of areas of gravitational turbulence. Let's get going.
Tell me you found something interesting.
Good morning to you, too.
Oh, just give me some good news, Dan. We're alive, and we're lost.
Funny.
Tom, I can't begin to tell you how much information we've been gathering. It's going to take years to study all this stuff.
Well, have you found a way to get us home?
Stellar cartography is taking care of that one. Me? I'm studying this place. Wherever this is.
I envy you. The captain has my group keeping our eyes open. I'm not really sure what that entails.
I'm sorry, Tom. I'm sure we'll find worlds to explore. And you're at the top of a very short list.
Just discover a planet or a way to get us out of here. Either way, I'll buy you a drink for your troubles. And you too, LaRoque.
Readings completed, Captain. The atmosphere is a sea of radioactivity, and the surface is pitted by thousands of craters caused by fusion bombs. Even the oceans have been boiled away.
That's the ninth planet we found this way.
What kind of creatures could be capable of something like that? Even the Klingons.
How long ago, Sonak?
Hard to say precisely. About 11,000 years. Give or take 1,000.
Is there any chance the inhabitants of this planet did this to themselves? Two factions fighting for control of the planet?
Readings indicate that this amount of destruction and residual radiation are almost certainly the result of an attack by a fleet of spacecraft. An attack that was designed to do precisely what it did. Destroy all life on the planet and ensure that the planet would itself be uninhabitable for any life forms for hundreds of thousands of years.
What kind of madhouse have we fallen into, Captain?
I don't know, Ensign. But at least all this happened a long time ago. There is no indication that the ones responsible for this are still around.
And nothing to indicate they aren't either. If they were capable of this thousands of years ago, what kind of weapons do you imagine they've developed by now, sir?
Captain's log. We have explored three more systems, and all were completely lifeless. However, we have discovered one planet with an antimatter power source still operating 5 kilometers below its surface, and that means a possibility of contact for us.
Amazing! I've never encountered anything quite like it.
Artificial life, perhaps?
Negative, Captain. At least no type of artificial life I'm familiar with.
Don't forget, this is another part of the universe. Who knows what could have been created here?
That's true, but this reading's different. In some ways, it appears to be a single being, and yet it's not. I'm sorry, I can't be more specific. I suspect what the pattern is, but I can't describe why it exists.
It's called intuition. It's from your mother's side of the family, that's all.
I think you're right.
An organic computer, then? Remember, the Federation experimented with it for some time, before Duotronics came along.
Possibly, Captain. Then again, maybe the readings are the result of distortion caused by the intervening rock.
At least whatever it is isn't shooting at us.
My own guess is, whatever it is, was put out of commission when the surface of the planet was destroyed. And that was 35,000 years ago. In any event, it's not the builder of the gate, and I can see no way of learning more without beaming someone down. Through 5 kilometers of solid rock and 1,000 kilometers of radiation to look.
You're right, Captain. It wouldn't be worth the risk just to satisfy our curiosity. Captain, sensors indicate an approaching craft.
Another cylinder ship?
I don't think so, Captain. There are indications it can move at warp speed.
Barry, Mr. Watts. 375,
Mark 23, sir.
Mr. Hansen, get that on the screen. Maximum magnification.
Aye, aye, sir.
Details, Donak.
Mass approximately 30 million kilograms. Heavy shielding indicated. Range 117 kilometers. Readings indicate that the craft is technologically comparable to early Federation cruisers of the Cochrane or Verne class. There are only 5 life forms aboard, however.
You mentioned shielding. What about weapons?
Unknown. But based on their shields, lasers are most likely. Their shields cannot resist our phasers.
Lieutenant Gibson, any indication of subspace radioactivity?
None, sir. It seems they're deliberately not broadcasting.
I agree with the lieutenant. From the amount and type of shielding, I'd say they're intentionally trying to avoid letting their presence be known. To another craft of the same technological level, they would be virtually undetectable beyond direct visual range.
Captain, do you think the ship is related to the destruction we've seen?
Sonak.
Impossible to say, Captain, but I don't think it's likely for a number of reasons.
All right, let's see who they are. Lieutenant Gibson, see if you can get any response.
Right away, sir. No response, Captain.
Reading sensor beams. They're trying to find us.
Let's not disappoint them. Mr. Hansen, lay in an intercept course. Proceed on impulse power. Deflector shields up.
Laid in, sir. Deflector shields up.
Gibson, continue broadcasting and monitoring all subspace frequencies.
Yes, sir.
They have locked in on us, Captain. Readings indicate definite laser weaponry. 60 seconds till they can be fired at us.
Our own deflector screens can handle anything they put out, I assume.
Of course, Captain.
Still no response, Captain.
Cease broadcasting, Lieutenant. Maintain surveillance of all frequencies.
Yes, sir.
Collision course, Captain. Impact in 10 seconds. Lasers preparing to fire.
Evasive maneuvers, Mr. Hansen.
Collision course again, Captain.
Apparently, they don't like us.
Apparently. If this is the way everyone in the neighborhood reacts to strangers, it's no wonder all these worlds were destroyed.
They're persistent too, sir. The ship is returning again.
How long can they keep this up, Sonak?
I would estimate not more than 5 minutes, Captain. No laser device can continue to produce that level of power for long, not without beginning to seriously malfunction. In addition, their repeated course changes are straining their power source and the structure of the ship itself.
Very well. When their weapons become inoperable, perhaps we'll be able to talk. Anything this time, Lieutenant Gibson?
Nothing, Captain, but that last transmission was very complex. Lots of information contained in that 4-second burst.
They're telling their friends about us?
A distinct possibility, Captain.
Sir, the ship is attacking again.
This will be its last run, Captain. They are deliberately inducing an overload. All matter and antimatter fuel will be simultaneously converted to energy in 30 seconds when they are at their closest range to the Hannibal. At that distance, our shields will not be able to withstand the energy release.
Mr. Hansen, shields down.
Down, sir?
Transporter room. Lock on to occupants of attacking ship.
Shields down.
Transporter's locking on.
Explosion in 10 seconds.
Got him.
Maximum warp and shields up.
Captain, I have them in transit. Shall I bring them in?
Transporter room? Keep them in transit until further orders. Security. Full detail to transporter room.
Security, we're on our way.
Let's go. Mr. Hansen, you have the con. Continue monitoring and keep me informed.
Yes, sir.
I would advise extreme caution, Captain.
Have some new information?
Yes, my readings indicate we only beamed over 4 survivors out of 12.
You mean the others weren't killed by the ship exploding?
No, it seems that when the first crew members were transported off the ship, the others just died with remarkable suddenness. Their life readings vanished within milliseconds. Even violent death isn't normally so swift.
Let's go. We don't know what we're bringing aboard. Whoever or whatever these people are, destruction, including self-destruction, seems to be the way of life with all of them. All right, Mr. Webb, let's bring one of them in. Security phasers on stun. Don't hesitate to use them.
Number one coming in now, Captain.
I would estimate the alien to be unconscious, if it falls within humanoid parameters.
Keep back anyway, Doctor, just in case.
Of course, Captain.
Reams, Creighton, check for weapons.
All right, Dr. Sparrow, he's all yours. Security, go with the doctor. Don't hesitate to stun the alien at the first sign of movement. Understood?
Yes, sir. Garcia, accompany the doctor.
Yes, sir.
It is difficult to know the alien's normal physical structure. But its injuries appear to be minor. This alien has one heart that is functioning at an accelerated rate. Again, it is difficult to know if this is normal. Captain, I will require the facilities of the ship's sickbay in order to ascertain more data about the aliens.
I understand, Doctor. As soon as...
It appears the alien has fallen into a shock-induced coma.
Everyone, get out, now!
Take the lieutenant down to surgery immediately. I will inform you of her condition as soon as possible.
Now safe to enter again.
Thank you, Mr. Thompson. Report to sickbay and keep me informed on Garcia's progress.
Yes, sir.
Obviously, you saw it coming, Sonak. How can we get the others on board and stop this from happening again?
Only to keep them unconscious, so they can't activate their devices.
You know what happened then?
I think so. There was a power buildup from a device buried deep within the being's body. similar to the power buildup from their ships.
At least they're consistent. What activates the destruct device?
I'm not sure, but before the power started building, the alien started moving its mouth. I'm guessing that they have a small transmitter implanted in their teeth.
Transporter's still online, sir. It's a little scorched, but working. All the aliens in transit are still there.
That's good news, I think. All right, people, listen up. We're going to try this again. I want you to monitor the alien's vitals at all times and to trust what the tricorder says, not how the alien looks or acts. If your readings give you the slightest indication that he's waking up, stun him again. Our job is to get him to the medical section to prevent him from vaporizing himself and us.
Yes, Ensign, what can I do for you?
I'm sorry to bother you, Dr. Crandall, but I felt I had to speak to you.
Well, that's perfectly all right. Won't you have a seat? For starters, how about telling me your name?
I'm sorry. My name is Davis, sir.
No need for the sir. I'm just a civilian, not an officer, Ensign.
I know, sir, but as a representative of the Council...
Only unofficially, as I'm sure you're aware, Ensign. But tell me, Miss Davis, what is it you wish to speak to me about? Much as I'd like to, I'm afraid getting you or myself shore leave is a little bit beyond my current capabilities.
I realize that, of course, sir. And I don't want you to think that I'm being disloyal to the captain in any way by coming to speak to you.
Of course not. In any case, one's ultimate loyalty is to the Federation itself. Not to any one individual. So please feel free to be completely open and honest with me. Whatever you have to say will be just between us. Unless, of course, you were to tell me specifically otherwise. Please, go ahead. Why not begin by telling me more about yourself? How did you get on the Hannibal, for instance? I seem to recall being told that this was your first assignment out of the Starfleet Academy.
That's right, sir. I just graduated 3 months ago. I don't know how I happened to be assigned to the Hannibal. Luck of the draw, I imagine. Even so, it was quite an honor.
I'm sure it was. The Hannibal, after all, is a highly regarded vessel.
Well, my classmates were green with envy. There wasn't one that didn't want the chance to serve with Captain Navarro.
But you weren't counting on anything like this, were you?
No. I wasn't. This was supposed to be a strictly scientific mission. We were supposed to be back on Earth in only a few weeks. My fiancé graduated last year, and he's on the Krieger, and we were both scheduled to be on the Republic next year. His family knows Captain Halston, and... I'm sorry.
No need to be. Graduating from the Academy doesn't mean you have to stop being human.
Thank you, sir.
You have nothing to thank me for. Believe me, I know how you feel. I don't have a fiancé waiting for me at home, but I do have family and friends. You said you had to speak to me, Miss Davis. I hope you haven't changed your mind.
No, it's just that... As I understand it, you're an expert on the gravitational anomalies the Hannibal was investigating. The anomalies that got us where we are now.
I know a little bit about them, yes. I was in charge of the laboratory that developed the detectors that the Hannibal is now using.
I understand that you don't agree with the captain's assessment of our situation. And, well, I just wanted to know what you think our chances are. Based on your knowledge of the anomalies, do you think we can ever get back to the Federation?
I rather doubt it. Not at least under the present command structure. As you said, I have my disagreements with Captain Navarro. In the first place, I strongly suspect we are wasting precious time chasing after this mythical gate civilization that she hopes still exists. What's even more disturbing to me, however, is the announcement the captain made over the intercom an hour ago that we've captured some of the local aliens capable of destroying us in seconds. This course of action can only lead to disaster, ruining what little chance we have of getting home. Unfortunately, I'm in no position to do anything about it. As the captain pointed out, I am on board strictly as an observer, despite my being, in effect, a representative of the Federation itself.
But there must be something you can do. Captain Navarro would certainly listen to anything you had to say, with your knowledge of the anomalies.
In the first place, I fear she does not share your estimate of my knowledge. In the second, starship captains are not known for their receptiveness to unsolicited advice from unwelcome civilians. And in her eyes and the eyes of her officers, that's precisely what I am. Not that I can fault them for that, of course. Are the rest of the crew for seeing me in the same light?
I'm not sure everyone feels that way. I certainly don't.
I thank you for your confidence. In any event, there's little either of us can do about the situation, except watch and listen. Has it occurred to you that we haven't been told everything concerning our contact with the aliens?
No.
What I'm saying is, while I'm sure the captain wouldn't lie, I can't help but fear that there are a few things she's simply not telling us. Believe me, I've often dealt with people in positions of power, both military and non-military, and they virtually never tell the public or their subordinates the whole truth. And I include myself in that category, Miss Davis. I have to admit that I have not always been 100% open. Now, I'm not saying that I ever did anything that I didn't honestly believe was in the best interest of the Federation in the long run. And I'm certainly not suggesting that Captain Navarro would ever do anything that she didn't firmly believe was in the best interest of her ship and crew. There have been starship captains who have put their own interests above that of their people, but Captain Navarro surely is not one of them. Her reputation for competence and integrity is among the best in the fleet, as you probably are aware. No, all I'm saying is that for what she sees as the best of possible motives, she is not letting us know everything that is happening, either with the aliens or the anomalies themselves. The problem is, since she is not as knowledgeable as she could be about the anomalies, she might just be keeping to herself the one piece of information that in the hands of someone more knowledgeable could be the key to our return to the Federation.
Captain's log, supplemental. We have safely removed the trigger mechanisms located in the aliens' mouths. Now that they are safely disarmed, I hope we can establish some communications between our species and find some answers to our present situation.
Will she be all right, Doctor?
The prognosis looks good, Captain. Our immediate detention was crucial in repairing the serious wound the Lieutenant suffered. I expect her to make a full recovery.
Good job, Dr. Sparrick.
I only did what was required, Captain.
Of course. What's the status of our guests?
They remain unconscious, although I have not ascertained why. The medication used to keep them sedated has been discontinued for several hours. I believe the creatures have placed themselves into a self-induced coma.
Keep security on them. I suspect they're only waiting for a chance to attack.
Informed.
little shaky from the phaser, but that's all. Which is to say, vastly preferable to the alternative. Thank you, Lieutenant Thompson. And some rings for your prompt action. Get this one to the detention cell. Put one of the others, just one, the taller one, in with him. And we'll watch and we'll listen and hope something develops.
Interesting.
Yes?
I believe the alien was indeed listening to our conversation, Captain. Although it couldn't understand our language, it ascertained that you were in charge.
So he'd know who to try to kill first.
You have to start somewhere. And it was a form of communication.
Dan?
I'm up to my ears in reports. Sonic has both science and medical departments working overtime. What's up?
I just escorted our guests to the brig. Not very talkative, but I don't think they should be underestimated. You might know a way to get us out of here.
If I know the captain, they'll talk.
Yeah, I wouldn't want to get on her bad side.
Which means I really need to get to work.
Damn aliens. They're ruining my social life. Could I stick around, maybe watch you run through those tests? I could take notes, maybe wash a beaker or two?
No! I wouldn't get any work done with you breathing down my neck. Go away!
Okay, okay.
Captain's log, supplemental. Our alien guests have remained silent during the last 10 hours. Meanwhile, the Hannibal's computers have been working on translating their ship's message sent out earlier. If this fails, I'm not sure we'll ever establish communication. Yes, Sonak?
The computer will be able to provide us with a rudimentary translation. Normally, a totally unknown language would require more extensive data and time, but their subspace message seems to have contained all that we needed to get started.
Excellent. How soon can we try the translator on them?
You should be able to exchange very basic information already, Captain.
Good. Let's go talk to them. Have the computer hook up with the portable translator in the brig.
Yes, sir.
Come on, Sonak. We are not your enemies.
Be silent, now!
I could have told you that. You do not need to be silent or keep any secrets from us. We are not your enemies.
I believe you are not the enemy.
It does not matter that he's not the enemy. The fact that our speech is known to anyone could lead to our destruction.
Who is this enemy you speak of?
The enemy. The destroyer of a thousand worlds!
We have found many worlds already destroyed. Did any nearby world survive these destroyers?
Not in this part of space.
Then your world is not nearby. I apologize. I realize you dare not reveal any information about the location of your world, for fear that it might enable your enemy to find you.
That is correct. When you say you are not our enemy, we believe you. But belief is not enough in matters as vital as this.
I understand. The location of your world is not important to us. But can you tell us what you call yourselves?
We are the Hoshin.
And yourselves? Your own personal names? My name is Elaine Navarro. And as you guessed earlier, I am in command of this vessel. And this is Mr. Sonak, my second in command.
Are we to be released, Elaine Navarro?
Very well. Lieutenant Thompson? Now will you tell us your names?
I am Tarasak.
I am Radzik.
I'm sorry that our earlier actions caused you and your crew members injury, and I thank you for your kind treatment.
We understand your reasons, In any event, I was not harmed, and Garcia will recover. Now will you come with me and explain to us who this enemy is?
There is little we know to tell. Our knowledge is limited to the slaughtered millions of our people, and the knowledge that we would all be slaughtered if given the chance.
But why? Why does he want to kill you? How did this war begin?
You have shown us the pictures of the worlds you visited, and still you can ask such a question?
I only meant, how did you first come into contact with the destroyers?
They attacked us just as they attacked you.
Was there an attempt at communication?
They only communicate with their weapons.
But your people did try.
Yes, the first ship's attack did try. But moments later, they were destroyed. Two other ships managed to transmit a subspace message before they were destroyed also. That description and those images are a central part of every Hoshan's earliest education.
What did the Hoshan do next?
At first, not knowing the extent of their power, we did little but avoid the sector of space where the attack took place. But then, one of our colony worlds was destroyed. Hundreds of thousands of Hoshan were killed. Shortly after, we began to find other worlds destroyed. We knew we were no match for these aliens and their planet-killing weapons. Our only chance for survival lay in remaining hidden from them, while we developed our own weapons, our own defenses. We had to retreat from space altogether, evacuating our colonies and destroying anything we could not take back with us. For decades, we worked only on our defenses. We have constructed a fleet of warships to match theirs and turned our planetary system into a fortress. Finally, after generations of sacrifice, we have grown strong enough to return to space, to begin seeking them out.
Even after all this time, you still don't know why they attacked you in the first place?
Ask them if you dare.
If we get the chance, we will.
You have already explained to us how you came to be trapped in our space, Captain, but I must ask, what is it you want of us? Why have you openly confessed your strengths and weaknesses to us?
Because we hope that if we demonstrated our trust in you, you might come to trust us, at least a little.
It is easy to trust those who are your prisoners and have no opportunity to betray you. If you truly wish us to trust you, use your great ship to help us wipe out the destroyers.
Captain, another ship, bearing 127, Mark 16.
Magnify the screen, Mr. Watts.
Aye, sir.
Sonak, is it Hoshan or Destroyer?
It doesn't match either profile exactly. There are 7 life forms on board, and it is traveling at warp 1.8.
Security, bring the Hoshan to the bridge immediately. Lieutenant Gibson, any subspace radio activity?
None, sir. It seems they're deliberately not broadcasting.
Weapons.
Similar to what we've encountered before. But they have a large antimatter core which will make their laser discharge considerably more powerful.
One of yours, Tarasak, or one of theirs?
8 minutes to sensor range.
Quick, Tarasak!
It is a destroyer. Will you help us now, Elaine Navarro?
How? By destroying the ship before we try communicating with them?
I see no other way.
I do. Sonak, prepare for a diversion.
A decoy probe, Captain?
Exactly. My guess is they'll lower their shields to fire at it, and then we'll beam them up. Lieutenant Gibson, Inform the transporter room to prepare for emergency lock-on.
Aye, sir.
Probe is ready, Captain.
Thank you. Mr. Hansen, on my word, fire the probe across that ship's bow.
Transporter room standing by, sir.
Range now, Captain.
Fire probe.
They're dropping shields.
Transporter room, beam that crew up now.
Transporter's locking on. Captain, I have them in transit.
Good work, Mr. Webb. Tarasak, I want you to return to your quarters until we've established some kind of communication with the destroyers. If they see you, there'll be no talking possible. Do you understand?
Yes, but they will not listen. They will only try to kill you.
I'm getting used to that. Here we go again, Sonak.
Indeed, Captain.
Do we have enough information in the computer to translate, Sonak?
Yes. The destroyer has been talking now for almost 2 hours. The language is complex, but we have enough information for rudimentary translation. Also, it seems that the creature became very docile when it realized that its suicide device collar was removed. So perhaps it's ready for conversation.
Let's go meet it face to face.
What are you?
We mean you no harm.
Then you are not the enemy? You are not the world killers?
We are not. We are from another part of space. We seek out other species for peaceful relations, for exchanges in ideas, for the mutual benefit of all. Could you tell us what species you are and what you call yourself?
I believe you are not the enemy, for the world killers do not talk, they kill. I am called Atragon, and my people are called the Zeator.
I am Elaine Navarro, and this is Sonak. We want to help you and your people end this terrible war. If we are able to convince you that we are not your enemy, you could direct us to your home world, and we could take you there directly and talk to your leaders.
There is no way I can be sufficiently convinced, not when the fate of my world hangs on my decision to trust you. But my decision is of no importance. I could tell you nothing of our homeworld's location, no matter what my decision. For I do not know its location. I am a soldier, and was told nothing of such matters. The rest of my life, I fear, must be spent elsewhere than with my own people. Whoever you are, once you took me from them, I became as dead to them as if the device you removed from me was activated. As dead as all those on our ship are to our own world.
I think it's time the destroyers met the world killers. Captain's log, continued. After many hours of debating, the Hoshen and the Zeator have both agreed to contact their commanders and try to arrange a meeting between both species. We have set up special communication links for Tarasak and Atragon to talk directly with their respected leaders, but so far there has been no response. Navarro here. What is it, Sonak?
Subspace contact with both the Hoshan and the Zator.
Where are they?
Both beyond our sensor range, Captain, and widely separated from each other. Both requested speaking with the commander of the Hannibal.
On my way. Time we put our heads together to find out some answers.
Yes, sir.
You are the Commander Elaine Navarro we have been told of.
I am Elaine Navarro, commanding USS Hannibal, yes.
I am in tracking, in command of our ship patrolling the slotted worlds.
I am Beltrokai. All Hoshan in the Zone of Destruction are my responsibility.
I am pleased you both have contacted us. I am also pleased that our gifts have enabled you to speak to one another.
Your devices are most helpful. Had they existed 100 years ago, many lives might have been saved.
Many lives can still be saved if you continue the contact you have begun.
Yes, that is our hope. And that is why we have contacted you, Commander Navarro. We have need of your great ship.
We will do whatever we can to help. What is it you wish?
As I am sure you can understand, Commander Navarro, 100 years of all-out war cannot be ended in a day, nor can trust be built in a similar period. Both will take time, and both will require more direct contact between Hoshan and Zator than can be accomplished through subspace links such as these. We must meet face to face if peace is ever to come.
Understood. Do you wish to meet then on neutral ground on board the Hannibal?
Neutral ground, yes. But more importantly, we both need your great ship to guarantee the safety of our own ships when we meet.
Could you not simply agree to disarm your ships?
Impossible.
No. We must face each other, not only individually on your Hannibal, but with our ships. There is no other way. If our efforts are to succeed.
He is right. We must meet peacefully. We must learn after centuries of war to trust each other. But during those first steps, we both must have your protection.
From each other? How can we protect you from each other?
We believe your presence alone will be enough. We have been told how powerful you are. If either of us attacks the other, you must be prepared to destroy whatever ship fires the first shot.
I wasn't aware that either of you trusted us that much.
We do not trust you completely, but we trust you more than each other at this point. And we have little choice. If we are to end the fighting, we have no choice.
On that we agree. With your help, Commander Navarro, we will succeed.
Very well. It will be as you wish. We will continue our subspace transmission so that you can follow them to our ship.
Thank you, Commander Navarro.
Yes. Thank you.
I don't like it, Captain. I wouldn't put it past either of them to rig up their own ships to blow, and then try and blame it on the other.
The thought had crossed my mind, Ensign. But we will inform them when they arrive that we can monitor that sort of thing. I only hope it's something that simple that they're up to. Captain's log. Dr. Jason Crandall has volunteered to act as neutral negotiator when the Hoshan and the Zieto arrive on the Hannibal. I believe his considerable experience in diplomatic matters qualify him as the best candidate, and a chance for him to feel useful as a representative of Starfleet.
See now, Navarro. I'll end this madness. I owe it to all of us.
I owe it to all of us.
I owe it to all of us. To end this insane voyage in this void of eternity. No more false hopes. No more wasting precious time. It ends soon.
I swear it.
Coming into range now, 27 Hoshan ships.
27? Belzerkas didn't say anything about bringing an armada with him.
Nor did he state otherwise, Captain. Perhaps, like humans, the Hoshan believe that displays of force are the proper prelude to talks of peace.
And how many did you say our deflector screens can handle?
11.
Sonak, make the necessary calculations for us to get the hell out of here if they decide to attack.
Already done, sir. If the Hoshan decide to attack, we have 10 seconds to get our shields up and engage warp engines. In 15 seconds, we will be out of their range of fire.
And if the Zieto have just as many ships?
If we didn't activate shields but engage warp engines first, we would have an 8-second margin of safety.
Time your calculations with the helm, Sonak.
Already done, sir.
Captain, the Zieto are now entering sensor range.
How many ships are they coming in?
31, Captain.
Tarasek and Atragon have returned to their people, Captain.
Thank you, Mr. Webb. Stand by. Dr. Crandall, it's your call. What's the next move?
Well, Captain, both Tarasek and Atragon are equipping their people with our translators and prepping them for their historic meeting. It should all take just a few moments, and then they'll signal us when they're ready.
Excellent. Good work, Doctor.
Thank you, Captain.
Captain, we're being hailed.
That was quick. Put me through to the Hoshan and the Zietas, Lieutenant.
Channel open, sir.
It is understood that for your safety and for our own, all delegates will be rendered unconscious for a short time so that we can verify your claim that each personnel self-destruct device has been deactivated.
Of course, Commander Navarro.
Of course, Commander Navarro.
Very well. We have the conference room prepared. As requested, it is equipped to allow each delegate to be in constant, virtually instantaneous visual contact with their own ships. Transportation will begin as soon as you give us the exact coordinates for your delegations.
Transporter room here, sir. I have received the coordinates from both the Hoshin and the Zeator. Ready to transport on your order.
Security.
Ready, Captain.
Mr. Sonak.
Ready to neutralize the devices if necessary, Captain.
Your delegations are ready?
They are, Commander Navarro.
They are, Commander Navarro.
Very well. Mr. Hansen, prepare to lower deflectors for transport.
Aye, aye, sir.
Mr. Webb, take the Hoshin first and don't waste any time.
Of course, sir.
Mr. Hansen, lower deflectors. Bring them back to full power the moment you hear from Webb.
Aye, aye, sir.
Having trouble locking on, sir. The coordinates don't...
Lasers on all ships preparing to fire!
Dan!
I'm alright, I need to activate the backup systems.
This section can be shut down at any moment. We've gotta go.
1 minute, that's all I need.
Don't make me pull rank on you.
You've got 1 minute. Where's LaRoque?
You go finish what you're doing, I'll look for him.
Computer!
Working.
Computer, transfer Sagan files 457-1A through 88BF to the secondary memory core. Activate immediately.
Working. Specified files are transferred.
You all right? That's it. Let's get out of here.
Execute immediately. Initiate safeguard program. Protect all Science Lab 3 files.
Alert! Power to the science deck is being rerouted temporarily. Alert! This area will close down in 1 minute 45 seconds.
Time's up. We're out of here.
Right. I've done all that I could.
ship must have taken some pounding.
Let me give you a hand.
Out of danger for now, Captain.
Thank you, Mr. Hansen, for everything. Get that piece of garbage off my bridge. Put him in the detention cell immediately.
We'll see that he gives you no more trouble, sir.
I have Hudson on the line, Captain.
Put him on.
Hudson here, Captain.
Report, Mr. Hudson.
We're critical down here, sir. The aft phaser coupling is blown and forward phasers are down to 30%.
What about life support?
They've been rendered temporarily inoperative on decks 9 through 12.
McPherson, did those backup systems turn on for those decks?
Yes, sir. Security reports everyone was safely evacuated from those areas.
Hudson, how long until we can repair it?
I have all available personnel working on it, sir. I estimate about 20 hours.
Get to it.
Hudson out.
I have more bad news, Captain.
Of course you do. What is it with you engineers anyway?
You know how it is. It's our dilithium crystals, Captain. They're badly overloaded. We can use them, but only sparingly. If you need to go faster than warp 4, or you need full power from the phaser banks, they'll give out altogether.
Warp 4 should be enough to keep us out of reach.
If the crystals don't give out sooner.
See that they don't, McPherson.
Aye, Captain. I'll do what I can.
Lieutenant Gibson?
Sick bay reports one broken arm, already set. Beyond that, some bumps and bruises, but nothing serious.
Communications.
All subspace channels functioning, sir.
And the Hoshin and the Zeta?
No longer broadcasting on any frequency.
Sonat, what are they doing?
They formed a single formation, Captain. They're trying to follow us at their maximum warp speed of 2.5.
And this time we don't dare let them catch us. Mr. Hansen, lay in a course to our original point of entry into this system.
Aye, aye, sir. We're going to look for the gate again?
Yes, we are.
Captain, there's another possibility we have not mentioned yet.
Yes, Sonic?
During our initial exploration, there was one planet which had anomalous readings coming from deep underground. Although it was unclear, our sensors did detect a sophisticated power source, perhaps an organic computer of some kind.
I remember when we couldn't get more information unless we beamed through miles of solid rock. Are you suggesting a second look?
I am, Captain. The planet does not lie far from the course we must take to return to our arrival point, so we'll lose little time. I strongly believe that this gate and the planet are connected.
All right, let's give it a shot. Just because our lives could end in a couple of days doesn't mean we can't learn something new.
My philosophy exactly.
Report.
The antimatter power source detected earlier is now fully operational, Captain.
Mr. Hansen, put up what deflector shields we have left and proceed over the area where the energy is being detected.
Aye, aye, sir.
Sensor activity, Captain. We're being scanned.
All stop, Mr. Hansen.
I'm picking up definite life form readings.
Similar to your earlier readings?
Negative, Captain. Those readings wouldn't register at this distance. The present ones are quite normal.
And whoever is scanning from down there is aware of us?
Definitely, Captain.
The gate people, sir?
Or the ones who destroyed these worlds in the first place.
Or both. Sensor scan strengthening, Captain. And now I detect transporter activity, originating from the planet.
What? We're still far beyond transporter range, Sona.
Far beyond our transporter range, Captain.
Mr. Hansen, get us out of here.
Aye, aye, sir.
Anyone can explain what's going on here, I'd appreciate it.
It's only a guess, but whoever brought us down here wants to communicate with us.
Sounds reasonable. But why is he here with us?
I really don't know, Captain.
I felt something touching my mind. I tried answering it, and suddenly I found myself here.
Could Crandall be the reason we're here? Could his mind contact trigger some mechanism?
Possibly, Captain. But rather than guessing, why don't we ask them?
I am Captain E.
Seems they're trying to communicate. But only Crandall seems to be receiving.
In his present state of mind, he could order them to destroy us. What can we do? Should we stop them?
How, Captain? They might deem our actions as hostile and protect Crandall if he's doing what you suggested.
I can see your thoughts. I was wrong, Captain. I was wrong about everything. I will try to help, but you must trust me.
It seems we have little choice. If you really want my trust, Doctor, tell them to release us. We mean them no harm.
I'll do my best.
Your mind can't take that pressure.
Just a few more seconds. I owe it to you and your crew.
Captain's log continued. We have made contact with a species called the Aragas. They have established contact with us through Dr. Crandall, who was seriously injured as a result. The Aragas has allowed me to contact my ship and have him beamed aboard for treatment. Personal note. Does this place hold a key for us getting home? Or am I wasting what little time we have left? I must protect my ship and crew, no matter the cost. But this is a hostile universe, and I will use all of my experience to survive whatever comes next. Akita, you said you came through the gate and were attacked without any warning?
Yes. We were a scientific expedition, and without weapons. All we could do was run. It was lucky for us that those who attacked us were attacked themselves. But we had sustained enough damage, and we had to abandon our ship. We discovered this planet's power source, and with the last of our ship's power, beamed down here.
Your records show you've been here for 5,000 years. Has your species lived that long?
No, Captain. I suspect that they've been using suspended animation chambers. Like this one here.
That's right. We adopted these tubes and connected them to the computer to awaken me whenever a ship entered the sector. If we were being rescued, I would awaken the rest of my crew.
Incredible. For 5,000 years, you waited to be rescued? Well, your ride is here, if you can explain how the gate that we both came through works.
The information is stored here. I will show you how it can be retrieved. Technology is really quite similar to yours. So interfacing with it should not be difficult.
I will feed the information directly from here to the Hannibal's computer, Captain. Time is of the essence.
Prepare your people, Akita. They have a very long trip ahead of them.
Sickbay here, Captain. You wanted to know the condition of Dr. Crandall.
Yes, Dr. Sparrow. How is Crandall? Will he make it?
His prognosis looks encouraging. There seems to be no permanent brain damage. But it would be some time before the full extent of his injuries can be determined. And what effect it has on his mind, both physically and psychologically.
Thank you, Doctor.
Over 50 ships entering our sector, Captain.
Sonak, we're running out of time.
The gate operates on a cycle of approximately 8.2 hours. During that time, it varies in size and destination continuously. Each transmitting window is 7 seconds in length. The gate itself will be 0.729 kilometers in diameter. It remains this size for much of its cycle, which explains why we were unsuccessful in our efforts to locate it before.
I don't suppose you found anything that explains how these things work.
Not specifically, Captain.
When is our window coming around next?
At our current warp factor, 2 hours.
Bridge to engineering. Report.
Captain, Hudson here. All repairs are complete.
Excellent work, Mr. Hudson. Keep my ship running.
Yes, sir. Hudson out.
Hey, Tom. What's the news from the bridge?
We're making a run for our entry point. It's gonna be close. If I have to roll up my sleeves and punch out every one of those aliens, I will. We're getting home, one way or another.
I hope it doesn't come to that.
I'm heading back to my section. Stay safe, Dan.
You too, Tom.
Give me Klingons any day.
May you live in interesting times.
Captain, the Hoshan and the Zeador have spread out directly in our flight path, less than a million kilometers from our gate.
They're contacting us, Captain.
Put them through, Lieutenant.
You speak of trust. If you truly wish us to trust you, surrender your ship.
If everything we have done so far hasn't convinced you that we mean you no harm, I can't imagine what would. As for the beings who may have triggered your great war, we have transmitted to you as much information as your computers can handle.
All very reasonable, but how do we know that you are not this enemy you speak of? That you didn't manufacture all this data up in your computer.
The very fact that we didn't wipe you out when we had the chance should be some indication. Even now, the odds are excellent that we can, if you force us, punch a very bloody hole right through the middle of your fleet. Sonak, how much time?
5.2 minutes, Captain. And the Zeator fleet has now moved to block off any retreat by us.
So it's now or never. If we wait, the crystals might not last, and we'll be completely surrounded. Lieutenant, open up a channel.
Channel open, sir.
We're coming through. You know how powerful our weapons are. But we will not fire unless we detect you are about to. We don't mean to destroy anyone, but we will, unless you let us through. It's up to you. Ahead, Mr. Hansen, impulse power. And keep that gate in your sights. All phases, lock onto targets closest to our path. Be prepared to fire on command.
Aye, sir.
Time, Mr. Sonak?
3.3 minutes, Captain. All weapons on all ships now activated, Captain.
Hold fire until they do, Mr. Hansen.
Closest approach to enemy ships in 63 seconds.
Captain, we're being hailed.
Put them on the secondary screens, Lieutenant. What is it? Have you decided to let us through?
Yes, we believe you, Captain Navarro.
Thank you, gentlemen, for finally taking a chance on something besides more killing.
Yes, a decision has been made. I just want you to know that we will do our best to see that you and your people are given a better welcome when you return.
If you return.
We'll be back. I'm sure now, we'll be back someday.
Gate in 10 seconds, Captain.
The crystals are giving out, Captain.
Steady as she goes.
Mission successful, Captain.
Well, Akita, it will take a little time, but soon the Federation will have you back on your home world. Only 5,000 years late.
Yes, at least as Sonic has told me. My people still exist. I was thinking, Captain, if I can convince my people to join your Federation, we will need an ambassador. Is Dr. Crandall available?
From what I understand, it looks good for him, considering the change he's undergone. Thanks to your telepathic contact, he's someone I could recommend for such a job.
Thank you, Captain. The final question for you.
Yes?
Back on the planet, you said you had a theory about the destroyers. May I ask what it is?
Well, both the Hoshen and the Zeta were attacked by an enemy who made no attempts at communication. It's possible that the attacks are a small part of what could be a millennia-spanning chain, an infinite one, including not only the Hoshen and the Zeta, but any race that's come out into space, into this sector, for the past several thousand years. Each one is attacked, each one of course retaliates, until eventually they arrive at the state that the Hoshen and the Zeta were in when we arrived.
But how did this chain get started?
Well, it would only take one evil force to start the chain reaction. Earth had its Hitlers, the Federation has the Klingons. Or it could have started with a misunderstanding. Like it almost did between the Federation and the Gorns. Without communication, it can only end in the destruction of one side or the other. And because space is so vast, the victors could not be sure they totally destroyed their enemies. And one day, a new species ventures into their territory, like you, like us. The newcomers are attacked, their ships are destroyed, because the survivors of that earlier war were unwilling or unable to take the chance that these newcomers might not be their old enemy, either resurrected or reincarnated.
It is a grim situation you speak of, Captain Navarro, if you believe such things are possible.
But remember this, Akita. As long as there are people willing to take a chance on peace rather than war, there will be survival. And the infinite chain will be broken.